Call the October 7th, 2013 USD 350 Board of Education meeting to order. Welcome to all the visitors. Mrs. Dixon, Mrs. Erina. Additions or changes to the agenda?
There are none.
Okay. Move to approve the agenda.
Mr. President, I move that we approve the agenda as presented.
Second.
Moving second to approve the agenda as presented. All in favor, aye?
Aye.
Aye.
What is that?
Creatures of habit.
Motion carries. Consent agenda. Minutes of the September 9th meeting, and we also had a special meeting in September. Bills for payment, budget report, activity fund report, should all be in your packet.
The bills, you notice there's three different formats. We've got our new financial software. The last of those reports is what the check register is going to look like from here on out. This is kind of how you're used to seeing it. And then this form, when we were trying to work it out, this is one of the pay runs. And then this is the one we finally came up with. So there's bills on every one that need approval, but this will be the format that we see from here on out.
Makes it easy.
Mm-hmm. And then the budget report, that may be tweaked just a little bit for next month. And then I'll have a lot more information here later on in the meeting about the budget.
I move the board approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the board consent agenda as presented. All in favor, aye?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay? Motion carries. 6-0. Patron comments tonight?
I could on the candy, but I won't.
Would you like some?
No, that's fine. I was just going to say, I would have added my old stuff if I'd have known this. You didn't tell, maybe.
Halloween's coming up pretty quick. Then you can get rid of it.
Okay. It's her old Halloween candy.
Well, that was crazy.
Okay, we'll move on to the business portion of the meeting. SCK-SCC interlocal agreement. Mr. Meyer?
This is just the agreement between all of the member districts of our special ed co-op. This is what gives them the legal authority to operate. It spells out how we manage that. They operate just like our school board. They're an independent board. They hire and fire and make contracts just like this board does. Each school district has a representative, so that makes it pretty unique. With all of those different board members. There's, you know, one of the things that spells out in here is how we're assessed the fee, how do we pay those bills, and it's based on enrollment and then some other management things there, but it's pretty much just standard legal operating language there. So we need a motion to approve that interlocal agreement.
Mr. President, I move the board approve the updated interlocal agreement between member districts and SCK-SCC as presented.
Second motion.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the updated interlocal agreement between member districts and the SCK-SCC as presented. Is there any discussion? Not all in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed, nay? Motion carries 6-0. ESDAC interlocal agreement.
This is the same setup. ESDAC provides our professional development. We also have our group health insurance through them as a larger pool. This is really just for the existence of ESDAC. The SCK interlocal agreement, we only need to update that as needed. If there's changes, the change that was, that happened there was Lewis joined the cooperative a few years ago, so it actually should have been updated a few years ago. ESDAC, it's only enforced for 5 years, so every 5 years we have to update that. So the difference here is there's a 7-member board. We don't have a board member that's on the ESDAC board. There's 7 regions or clusters, and one board member from each cluster represents. So that's how that works.
Any other questions about ESDAC? I'd entertain a motion to approve.
Mr. President, I move the board approves the updated interlocal agreement between the member district and the ESDAC as presented.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the updated interlocal agreement between member districts and ESDAC as presented. Is there any discussion? Not all in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay.
We are.
Motion passed, 7-0.
Way to go, Tom.
Moving on, board goals.
I just realized I didn't get those on the right page, like I said, I did on in your packet there. Let me pull them up here. I shared these with you. A rough draft last time. A lot of them, this is from our goal setting session back in August. The goals would be to provide adequate resources for technology in the classrooms, ensure students have access to quality programs, opportunities, and resources. Last year, that goal was more about advanced courses and career opportunities, and this kind of expanding that to just making sure we have opportunities for all kids. Provide for well-maintained, updated, safe facilities. Recruit and retain highly effective staff, and maintain updated board policies and procedures. So those were the 5 we came up with, and then a few objectives under each goal.
Mr. President, I move the board approve the board goals for 2013-14 school year.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the board goals for 2013-14 school year. Is there any discussion? Not all in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries 7-0. Budget update.
To start off with here, I've got updated budget report for this year. This is some historical information as well as a report on the budget as we published in August. You like a copy?
Sure. Thank you.
This provides some historical information about our budget. Not something maybe that you'd sit down and just read through, or anybody in the community would, but it is a good point of reference. If you ever have a question about how does something work, why don't we spend money this way, or how have we been spending our money in certain funds, it's a good place to look. So the first page just spells out some information about how our budget works, the timeline for publication and those things, and then our mill levy, and a little bit about the state budget in general. Page 2 discusses the valuation in our district and the mill levy and what all that means. Shows a historical perspective of valuation, overall mill levy. Then there's also a graph there that or a table that shows mill levy for each fund for the school district. And then the rest of the document, for the most part, just spells out each fund. So at the bottom of page two is the general fund, and where does that money come from, where does it go, and then historical expenditures for 10 years. Page three talks about enrollment numbers, or FTE, which is full-time equivalency, and how some of those things work to create our budget and base state aid per pupil. And page four, at the bottom there, discusses equalization aid. We don't get any equalization aid. Our valuation is high enough. Some districts that don't have a very high valuation, they can't levy as much in taxes for each mill. So the state provides aid. And then the rest of this is really just the funds, and periodically there's some explanation of certain things. For example, on page five, the budget authority. Our budget is established at $550,000 for capital outlay this year. That's not what we expect to spend, but we set the budget there in case we do need to spend it, and we don't have to republish that. Page six, in addition to the special ed fund, talks about transfers. Most of our money comes into the general fund and supplemental general, and then transfers out to different funds from there. Page seven and eight and nine, for the most part, are just talking about specific funds in the budget. Also page 10. Page 11 discusses our cash balances and the situation there. And a little bit about the library and the Recreation Commission. And then the last page is just the budget as was published for this year. So there's a resource for you. This information is on our website. So if people have questions, you know, you don't need to have all the answers, but it is sometimes nice to have that information at your fingertips. Other information about the budget, the cash balance situation. Is that big enough for everybody to read? This is in your supporting documents here. This is page 41. This shows the cash balance in selected funds in 2012 at the end of the year, the end of that fiscal year, and then the end of last fiscal year. And these are all funds that we think of this as spendable money. This is flexible money that we can use however we need to. It's in the vocational fund, so we need to spend it on you know, industrial arts or family consumer sciences, but it's flexible. We can move that there as we need to. These funds we carry a balance in, but we can't just choose to use them how we want. So when the auditor was here, she presented our cash balance situation overall decreased by about $13,000, which is next to nothing out of $1.2 million. But then when we look at our spendable balance, this is what I focus on. What happened here? You see it dropped by about $68,000 from last year to this year. Part of that can be explained by we had some expenses from last year that were actually expensed in the prior year. So it didn't drop quite as much, but the end result is still the same. That just kind of helps me look at how did we do from one year to the next. So then, so these really don't matter. We can't touch those monies anyway. This just helps us lower the levy for the upcoming year. Recreation is their money. That's only spent by the Recreation Commission. Bond and interest, this will go away. That cash balance won't be there next year. So this total number will drop by quite a bit for next year. And here's kind of the historical over the last 3 years, how we have dropped our cash balances. Okay. This number here on our spendable cash balance, that's flexible, we're okay there. We just can't keep doing this. We can't keep dropping it by that amount. And two ways to change that, we get more money, or we cut expenditures. And one of those we can control, the other one we can't really control. We can't really control how much money comes in. Now, another thing from that conversation would be, well, what should our cash balances be? What should our goals be? And we've looked at some numbers just to see. A good business practice would be to have 2 months working capital. So we could operate our business for 2 months without any revenue. We're not a business, we're different, but it's still a good point of reference. So what I did is took our actual expenses, averaged that out for monthly expenses, and 2 months, you see down at the bottom, is that $618,000. That would be a good goal for us to have in those funds. And then from that, we can't carry money in our general fund, so we can't carry that money there. So we need to spread that out over the other funds. And came up with recommended balances for each fund. Since it's blown up, you can't see what each fund is. But and then just an explanation of why would we set it at that. For example, special ed, $160,000 would be roughly one full year of our local assessment. That's the bill they charge us for the special ed service. So we're at the 377, we ought to be here. First goal is to turn this around so that number's not going down. Then this is kind of a secondary goal. Where should we be? Any questions on what I've just mentioned so far?
Well, I got a question.
Yes.
A few years ago, you know, we were trying to increase that. And then here in the last 2 years, or last year, correct me when the time was, the state said you need to get rid of this, and then we started spending this down.
Yeah.
Who said to go back up, or why did we come down just because he said so?
Was that on capital, that one?
No, that was just our
they said you couldn't have so much
reserve.
Contingency reserve, it used to be the maximum was 6%. Then they bumped that up to 10%, and that's where we had been for a couple of years at 10%. That's when it went to its maximum in our district. And there was all the discussion about school finance and the lawsuit, and schools have too much money. So the recommendation in a lot of districts was spend some of your cash balance down, and then we'll be okay. Then the lawmakers can't say schools have too much money.
Right.
So I guess that is the idea there.
Okay, so but now then, well, you know, we can't keep spending it down, but how can we go from where we are to 2 months when the whole thing was districts are being criticized for having too much, and we're going to go clear up to there.
I don't think I can justify $620,000.
Well, I
if
could
we
too.
Have,
I'm just
yeah.
Just,
if we have you know, $1.2 million, now we can start questioning. I think my recommendation is if we're at that level, we can safely say we're spending money on education. And what we've got in the bank is to get us through the lean times. Where we're at now, if we have a major cut in state funding, we have to make decisions immediately. Let's say in February they tell us we're gonna cut another $200,000 out of your budget. We don't have any wiggle room. If we had the $620,000, we might be able to work through another year, spend down that cash balance, and then make the decisions over the course of a year rather than a few months. We've got to cut four teachers. So I think it's easy to justify that. What they do in neighboring districts, that's up to them, and statewide. a lot of the discussion was statewide, school districts have this much cash balance, and it needs to go away, schools have that money. The reality is, of that situation, about half of the cash balance statewide was in two funds, capital outlay and bond and interest fund. And I can't recall what the percentage is, I've got it in the document. But capital outlay, we save that for building projects and bond and interest, that's there to pay for your bond payment.
I would agree, $377,000 is uncomfortable for an organization of this size, for an ending cash balance. What are your feelings about next year?
Well, let's continue what I have here, and that may answer. For this year, I mentioned there's two ways to control your budget, get more money or change your expenditures. The way we get more money is our enrollment. So our preliminary enrollment figures, these are pretty solid. These are the numbers that turned in today. See, audited headcount, that's the number we actually had last year, was 342 total. Anticipated for this year is 348, that's what I turned in. The number on the bottom there, you see the K-12, 306 last year, 315 this year, that's another comparison. The FTE number is actually how we get our funding, our enrollment FTE. So we're up, 8 or so there. So that's good news. We have a couple more in our non-graded, which is the adult learners, and that's tough to plan on. And there's not really a specific area where we're gaining more kids. So that's the numbers we turned in. There's a couple of graphs on here. This is in your packet as well, but our enrollment, the FTE enrollment, kindergartners count as half. We don't count all the preschoolers. If a kid's only here part-time, we don't count it as a full FTE. So that's why the number's not the same as counting heads. So that shows what our enrollment has done. Pretty flat, and then up the last 2 years. One thing that somebody had asked last year, what about our free and reduced lunch count? What has that done? So,
how do we get those 315 to 332? 348? 315 to 348, and then 332.
Good question. This is our head count. When we count heads, pre-K, we can only count the kids that are special education. So there's 12 of them, and they don't count for a full FTE.
Is that our September 20th?
This is our September 20th numbers, yes. Okay. Yeah. And then kindergartners, we count them as half. Unless they're special ed and they're here all day, then we count them as one. So that's why this isn't just half of that number. And then for the most part, these are all one. And our non-graded, depending on if they're here for the full time, if they're putting in all the time. We have one senior that's here part-time going and doing some vocational stuff later. So that's how we get from the 348 to the 332.7. Now, this is just to look at K-12, what's our number? Because pre-K is tough to count, because we don't ever know how many are going to be special ed and are non-graded. That just depends on who's going to be operating that program and whether they're going to be doing that.
Do you get more FTE for like special ed and like reduce some free lunches and stuff?
We do. We get extra weighting on top of this.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, on our enrollment FTE, then we add for vocational classes, kids we transport, for special ed, for a lot of different things. And that's what this number is here. Last year, this was our enrollment FTE, and we count all those kids and do that figuring, that was a 324 and a half. After all the weightings, this is what it was, 681.7. And then on top of that, they weight the special ed, which we don't really get extra money for the special ed kids. What they do is they say, you're getting this many dollars in special ed, what does that mean for FTE? So really, it's just to add to our budget.
So on that one, in the senior class, and you said they're going to a half-day vocational, we lose them in that sense, but we still gain them when we get the FTE weighted?
Yeah.
So it's a, is it a wash, or is it, do we get a little more back from the weighting?
It is, and this is a special situation. We can, I won't get too specific about this student, but he chose to do something else that we can't really... You know, we can send kids to Barton, or we can put them in our lab or something like that, and they're our kids the whole time.
I was just wondering if you always want to encourage them to do something to give them a head start. Yeah. Are we backfiring and penalizing ourselves for doing that?
Right.
But we still get the...
For the most part, no, we're not. We don't have to make that decision on what's best for the kid and what's best for our budget. We can work with the community colleges around here, but this is a special situation. We're going too far for us to do that, and we couldn't make that work.
Okay.
So our weighted FTE, when we add all the weightings in, and then our special ed funding. So I don't even count in the special ed funding. So that's what this number is here. If we count last year's general fund without special ed, because that money just comes to us from the state, and we send it off. We don't even see it, we can't use it. And then this year. And then our local option budget, this was high. I padded this budget. This is our maximum budget. If you remember last year, it was padded, not padded high enough, so we couldn't capture some of that. It's gonna be the same situation this year. I padded it even more. And so I guess the bottom line is, we're going to be money ahead. Our general fund and our local option budget, you see the difference of about $120,000 there. If we count in the amount we overspent, we lost about $68,000 in cash. And then some things we know are more expensive this year. Our insurance, we know our special ed assessment is higher. So if I figure those things in, best case scenario, I think we're going to be about $13,000 ahead. Now, we have more kids going to through ESNAC. If you remember, we have to pay that FTE or that base state aid to them. So that's another three. So that really wipes all that out. But being even is a lot better than being $68,000 in the hole. So I think we're going to be a lot better off this year with that increased funding. So as far as Chad's question about what do we do, we see where the budget is going to come out here with our audit, and kind of have some of those discussions over the next few months.
And stopping the bleeding as of then, after what do we have, four straight negative years?
As far as losing cash?
Yes.
Yeah. This will play into those discussions as well on enrollment projections. This isn't scientific at all. If you see, our two largest classes are 9th and 11th grade. And two smallest classes are in 5th and 6th grade. So when these classes leave, of course, we need to be filling with classes that are that big or larger. So what I did was just took this year's numbers and projected them out to next year. I just took these four numbers and kept them the same. And the rest of them just, if we kept the same kids in each grade level. So really, if everything was the same each year, what would our total number be doing? And it's a... you know, a fairly steady decline. And if you're curious, this is what our high school enrollment would look like. So if things stay the same, our enrollment will be dropping. Take into consideration also our non-graded students, if they're going to be around, we're going to continue to have that many in that program, that affects that as well. So, I think your phrase, stop the bleeding, that's kind of where we're at now. And keep in mind too, we can use this budget number next year as well, our enrollment number. So, if these enrollment numbers hold after our audit, that makes things a lot more comfortable. And all the while, we still need to make sure we're being as efficient as possible. Any other questions on that information there?
A lot to take in. Anything, Mr. Meyer? You'll keep us posted if anything varies?
No.
Okay. All right, moving on to capital improvement planning. I'll start this discussion by talking about the roof. I believe you have.
I didn't send the information about the roof in your packet, but it is on your iPad there. The one that is IR report, that's the infrared report. You can take a look at it. There's not a lot of information there. Bottom line is, our roof is in really pretty good shape. That is we probably got $1 million worth of roof up there. And right now, the way he explained it to me is, it's like your car's got some, it needs an oil change and it's got some bald tires. You need to fix those things, take care of them, it's going to be all right. We don't want to just replace the car. I understand the concerns about flat roof. We're always going to have trouble with that. And there may be a time where we need to change what's going on up there. But for now, I think the recommendation is let's fix what we have. There's really only one spot that there is a problem with our roof. And that's right above the entrance outside my office by the auditorium. That's where the insulation under the roofing is wet. There's lots of other places where we have water getting in. Some of those are mechanical fixtures where it's not getting under the roof, it's getting down the vent pipe into the building, or along the walls where flashing has come loose, or expansion joints in the brick. So most of our issues don't have to do with the roof itself. They have to do with the mechanical parts going through the roof or flashing and joints and those things. So what, kind of right in the middle of this, he has spelled out a project, roughly $30,000 worth of repairs is his estimate now. We're moving pretty quickly on this. Steve is his name from CRS, Complete Roofing Source. This is the folks we have the contract with. We approved that last meeting. So he sent this today. Contractors are coming in Thursday for a pre-bid meeting. I don't think this is on your sheet there. But he's come up with a list of recommendations all over the roof to take care of pretty much all the leaks that we have now, the obvious things, and where we found the moisture. At some point, we need to add some drainage. We won't be able to do that right now. One of those places is above the cafeteria. We need to poke a hole in the roof, put a drain there. It wasn't designed correctly. Water is pooling there because of a design problem. and the roof is in good shape, it just, if the water sits there, it's gonna find a way in. So fix those leaks there, and then this summer, we'll have to come in and put a drain in there, and they'll be able to run the drain pipe above the ceiling, under the roof, out the side. And there's another couple of places where we probably need to do that to get that water off of the roof. But we can't do that without really disrupting the building. And so this project here would be to take care of those repairs immediately, as quick as we can. They're coming in Thursday, bids will come in a week later, and we'll have to meet and accept those bids. So I'll send you this this project manual that lists all of the areas that need repaired. And I have that list. And again, it's roughly $30,000 for this first set. Any questions about the roof and where we're at there?
How long did he think until we need to have it looked at again?
We haven't, you mean as far as replace
with this,
or?
With this contract, does he come back every year? Or?
No, we could work that out where he does. But he'll have a 3-year budget and a maintenance plan for us.
So this is a 3-year work in progress?
He won't do this every year of that. But he, part of that contract was to lay out a 3-year plan of maintenance and budget for that. Our roof needs some attention every year, and we need to be doing some, maybe not contracting with somebody like this, but every year. But we do need to be getting contractors in at least every couple of years to take care of maintenance on this roof.
I think the darker the shade is, the colder it is. Is that right? The purples are cold.
Yeah. Here's them. Tall.
And it's actually, okay. It's actually backwards of what you might think. If it's, they do that at night, so when it, maybe explaining this wrong. It's opposite of what you might think. You might think of wet as being cooler than everything else surrounding it, but it's backwards because at night the dry parts lose the heat faster than the wet parts, so the wet parts hold that heat in. So that's why they do it in the evening. You see some of those pictures are right at dusk, and some of them are actually after it's been dark. So we'll have to have a special meeting just to look at those bids from the contractors and accept those. I don't have a date for you right now. So we'll, as long as we can pull together at least a quorum.
Well, what did you say? He was going to be here Thursday, start working on the road?
No, he's going to be here with me and David, and the contractors are going to come in and look at the roofs rather than just reading what needs done. They'll be here to look at things. We can explain it to them. So that's the pre-bid meeting. And then they'll have about a week to get the bids in, and then we'll have to meet and accept those and get to work right away. And I feel very comfortable with what he's given me here with just covering ourselves with, requiring that they have that the contractors have insurance and spelling out the specifications of products that they're going to use, materials they use, things that David and I can come up with.
Good.
So I'll be in touch about all the roofing repairs. And that special meeting we'll need to have to accept the bid. This is the list on page 44, what we had at our special meeting. We had some discussions about what to do with the offices. I took that out because it's really not construction. Really, the priorities were what we need to take care of now. There's not a lot of things we can pick and choose. And really, that's the library air conditioning system, our track resurfacing, the bathrooms, remodeling the bathrooms, drinking fountains with that, and our lighting in the old gym. Doesn't necessarily have to be part of a big project. That should be something we can take care of fairly easily. So those are really the priorities where we ended up. We're kind of running out of money to do things if we do all of those things. Does that kind of sum up the priorities there, or where at least we needed to start? The kitchen freezer building might be something we need to include in that, depending on the cost. But that needs to be done as well. But kind of like the lighting, we might be able to just take care of that on our own. And you see there's a lot more things on the list. One thing that plays into this is our vehicle replacement schedule. And I'm asking you to approve this vehicle replacement schedule. We wouldn't be binding the board 5 years down the road to purchase a vehicle. We'll revisit this every year. But this kind of gives us a place where we have board direction of what we're going to do with our vehicles. These two pages on your supporting documents looked at our rough mileage each year and the age of the vehicles and where we're going to end up. We've already replaced that wheelchair bus with the van. It's working out great. We do have another route bus that we haven't used for several years. We need to get rid of that. So we'll need to dispose of those two, which is another item on the agenda. We had discussed last meeting about replacing that Toyota van with the 15-passenger van. The state bid list, we missed the deadline to get that done for the 2013 model, so we'll have to wait until they come out with that for 2014. And it takes a couple of months to even get that deal done once it comes in. So I didn't really anticipate having that until later in the year. We do need to replace one of our Suburbans. You see we've got two that are near 150,000 miles. I think we can hold off on that until next year. Money-wise would probably be prudent. And then the following year, our Impala is going to get up there in miles. We can keep running vehicles forever and ever. We do reach a point where we're sinking lots of money into them. If it's my vehicle, $1,000 here, $500 there, might make more sense than replacing the whole vehicle. With our budget, the way it works, whenever I repair the vehicles, that comes out of our general fund budget. When we purchase vehicles, that comes out of our capital outlay, which we have a lot more leeway to do what we need to do with that money. It doesn't mean we need to buy a new vehicle every 2 years, but we do need to keep them, our vehicle fleet, refreshed. So we're not spending that general fund money, keeping our vehicles going longer than they should be. And with our car, we'll probably replace that with a minivan. The car we use, we can really only put, a driver and four kids in it. Minivan, we can get six or seven in there. Gas mileage isn't a lot different. So my recommendation would be replace that with a minivan. And then one of our buses we're going to need to replace here. My recommendation now would be in 4 years. And then another one, perhaps the fifth year. A lot of the buses depend on what are we going to do with our routes, what's our need. So what I've done there is just estimated the cost at the bottom and kind of came up with a recommended budget for a capital outlay. So all of that discussion about our vehicles leads us into this. There's a lot of information here. First will be the budget for this year. We do need to replace our fire alarm system. They're working on a bid for that right now. We're on an old 110-volt system. We have to replace that to a battery backup system. We've had so much trouble with it here when we replace intercom. I'll be glad when we get it done. Our vehicles, we've discussed those. Equipment and furniture, technology. We need to replace some laptops in one of the carts at the high school. They're about 10-year-old laptops. We bought them maybe 6-7 years ago. Mrs. Wybright's room. Refurbished. And we need to replace the batteries. Several thousand dollars just to replace the batteries. We need to update those. So that's, we still have, that'll be about $16,000 on that. And then repairs and remodel is anything with the building, painting, water heater, any of those things. And then our playground, we're pretty much done with that. We've spent pretty much what we're going to spend there. That entire budget would leave us with a cash balance of about $245,000. We will have leftover money in our bond and interest fund. We can transfer that over to capital outlay unless we think we're going to have a bond issue at some point. But the plan now would be just to move that over. I think a good goal would be to maintain a cash balance of $250,000. If we have a huge repair we need to take care of, we need some money there. I guess that's not a firm number, and it wouldn't hurt us to be below that. But I think this board ought to come up with a target number where we think we ought to be. That's up for debate. Any thoughts on that right now, what this board would be comfortable with?
For an ending cash?
Yeah, to maintain that balance. At the end of the year.
Sounds good.
Thoughts?
Yeah, $250,000.
Barb?
Well, I just think we've got to be. I think we got to keep making repairs every year. Looking back on here, I think there's several years that we maybe were a little lax, and that's probably what's caught us up in the bind. So I'd say $250,000 is comfortable with everybody else. So it's fine with me. So
we've got a lot of facility with a lot of things that could go wrong.
And this isn't a hard number that if we go below that, we need to come back to the board and say, can we spend below that? That would give us a target that we kind of need to be there.
What do we do when it comes time for replacing a roof that needs to be building? More than that over a period of time, so that when the time comes, you have the money to pay for it?
Yes. We will need to do that.
So, is it, let's say 250, but then it's what it needs to be now, but 5 years from now, it needs to be 350 or 400.
It could be, yeah. And there are a lot of questions need to be answered, too. And when might we need to replace the roof? Yes. Yeah, it does.
Or when you got to do the track.
Yes. Well, we can levy 8 mils, and that's what we agreed to do. So.
Right, but you got to be prudent on what you're spending today so that you have that money next week, mm-hmm. next year.
Right. Yeah, you're absolutely right.
So, yeah, that's 250 is a good place, but then doesn't it need to be increasing so that when that big expenditure comes, you're coming back down to the 250?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It doesn't matter how much money you have in there?
No.
That's the one thing we can control.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
punches in there.
Yeah.
I don't want to get to the point where there are some schools are spending everything and then they're in trouble.
Yeah.
And that's what's causing them to close down. I don't want to get to that point.
So looking at a budget for down the road, you know, vehicles play into that. Technology, we haven't identified any, you know, we need to keep up with technology, but do we want to do something further, for example, a one-to-one initiative? When are we going to need to replace the roof? Is there something else large that we need to save for? But what I've put together here is our average yearly expenses over the last 6 years, minus a few things. Like the bleachers was a large expense. That wouldn't really figure into our average expenses for the year. Or things that were reimbursed, like our intercom system. We got reimbursed from insurance, some things like that. And then our vehicle budget, if we can budget about $60,000 for that each year for the next 5 years, even though the planned expenses aren't that much, that's why I put this extra table in here. If we plan on next year being 40,000 and the year after that being 25 and then 80 and 80 for buses, if we just budget $60,000 for that for the next several years, we keep track of that internally. We'll make sure we have that. Kind of like Stan was talking about, on a short-term basis, we might have a little more in there, but we know we can, we don't have to scratch together that 80 grand in 1 year. And then just using those things and looking up, what have we spent over the last several years? What's our averages? And with the vehicles, what do we plan to spend? And technology, again, that comes from our last 6 years. You see it's a little higher than what that was. So these, this debt payment is really there as a maximum. What could we comfortably do for some sort of debt payment for large projects all at one time, if that's the way we wanted to go? 8 mils is about 336,000. It's a little more. So I wouldn't feel comfortable getting too close to that mark. If our valuation drops and our local option budget mill levy increases, if we've committed ourselves to that 8 mils, we don't have any wiggle room in the capital outlay mill levy. Then our only choice would be to raise the mill levy or drop it in local option budget. And that would be, then we pay teacher salaries with those things. So we don't want to be too maxed out here. Now the vehicles, equipment, technology, and repairs, those numbers are somewhat flexible. So those aren't necessarily going to be that high every year. And really the next several years are no different than that. Looking at debt, this is just for if we would have a lease purchase, a rough payment. If we would borrow anywhere from 250 to a million, and I just put 2 years on there, 7 years and 10 years. This is figured at 5%, I believe. What would the payment be? And then that equated that to mills in the other column. So just to give you a reference of if we would borrow money, where would we be there? So that brings us all the way to what are our priority projects? HVAC for the library, track, old gym lights, bathrooms, those numbers. The track is pretty close. The old gym lights, probably, again, we probably don't need to borrow money on that. But remodeling bathrooms, our HVAC system, and the track, those are three large expenditures we don't have the cash to do right now. those projects, let's bring 360 Energy Engineers back into this mix. We can use them for the HVAC system here at the library. We could have them engineer it, bid it. They're not going to do all the commissioning and all of that. They'll do that. They'll do it just like we would hiring another engineering firm. They will need the guaranteed energy savings. We don't need to pay for that. We can still use Joe Hurla and his outfit for that. Or we can use another firm to help us through that. They can't help us with the bathrooms if we're going to remodel them. We need an architecture firm to help us with that. They could help us engineer some things. Of course, they'd love to have our business. But the other folks I've been talking to, they're an engineering firm and an architecture firm. They do it all in one. So they could handle whatever we want them to do. So I guess the moral of the story is, with what we've got listed here, even just the HVAC and the bathrooms, I don't think 360 Energy Engineers is the way to go. I think we would be stuck working with an architect separate from them as well. We might as well just work with one firm to do that.
Thoughts on that? I agree. I don't think we need 360 if we're just going to do the project here in the library. Getting in here.
Now, if we were just going to do that, I would compare what 360 is going to charge us and what somebody else is going to charge us. Because then we're just talking about engineering costs. We don't need design work for laying out the bathrooms or anything like that. So if we're just going to do that, I would consider Joe and his firm with somebody else. But we just wouldn't do the guaranteed energy savings and the added cost with that.
Well, it's common sense that we will save energy replacing a 35-year-old system.
I hope so.
You know? So we need to decide tonight whether to use 360 or not.
Yeah. Well, he'll hang on as long as we need to. But to do the projects that he proposed, it's time to make a decision on that. And we don't need formal action, but again, we could still use them, just not with the project that he proposed.
So if we don't go with them at this point in time, what do we owe them?
Nothing. And again, if we're just going to do the HVAC system here, it may benefit us to use them. They've been here studying things.
Well, that's my opinion. See if they do the library part. You kind of had three different proposals there, and I guess we had to pick one. But, you know, he's already done a lot of that.
I guess my thought would be to get other bids if we're just going to do the library.
I mean, I'd like to see us do more. And I know that's putting our neck out there pretty far. But the bathrooms are just, they really need some service.
And what I heard at our last meeting was bathrooms are a priority. HVAC system here has to be done. We really don't have a choice. We'll reach the point where we do without or we fix it.
And this track, $170,000, is just to fill the cracks, or is that just totally?
That would be to tear off the existing surface, repair the cracks on the surface underneath, and then lay down a new rubberized surface.
Filling current cracks is what, 5 to 7?
35.
Are these the same people touch up in colleges and things like that?
This is the company we've worked with for years and years.
Is there another company out there that we can try to get comparisons and find out if we're getting taken?
We would absolutely do that.
I thought we did when we, last time we spent a bunch of money on that.
It might not hurt just every time. I mean, prices change.
Yes, if we, yes, if we replace it, it would be a bid situation, yeah.
How did we arrive at that $250 on the bathroom? Is that just kind of a shot in the dark?
It is, yes.
I'm trying to hands around it.
I can't imagine it could be done for that.
I can't either, but you've got a lot of bathrooms.
No, I think you're gonna start something and it's gonna turn into a nightmare. I really do.
How many bathrooms are there? Eight, ten?
I'd like to put the grade school as our first priority on bathrooms. The older kids tend to have more free time to walk around and go to different bathrooms if they can choose for the grade school point. And find right there.
Yeah, you're gonna get in them walls and.
Gotta start somewhere, Stan.
I know, but I'm just imagining the nightmare.
Yeah, I would agree with Vance. I think the elementary is where we start.
The high school hallway, that's a tough situation with those restrooms. With the boys' restroom, we've seen that. What do you do with that to make it more private and more usable? It'd be nice if it was on the ground floor, but there's not room for it. But when we're talking about remodeling the bathrooms, we're talking about gutting them and starting from scratch.
In the elementary, those restrooms are so small to start with. Mm-hmm. How are you gonna, I guess, stalls, do they make them in any size that you need? Because I'm just thinking, doors opening and shutting.
Well, once we start.
Any room in there and.
They're kind of grandfathered in right now. You're gonna have to be ADA after you start remodeling them.
I think you probably just have to have an handicap.
So that's gonna make your stall issue.
You know, you're gonna have either a unisex one or one for the boys that's handicapped and one. Girls been to all of them.
Well, that's something
our office, you know, the architects and people paying all that stuff.
Yeah, that's why you have architect come in and look at it, and then they tell you what you can do and what you can't do.
Yeah.
Well, when we walked around, we all were pretty committed to getting hot water down there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. We all agreed that it wasn't up to our standards as far as a grade school bathroom. So that would be a logical place to begin.
What's Mrs. Dixon think?
I agree with that.
Most of us bond issue of past fixed bathrooms.
Well, and we don't.
I don't think we need a bond issue.
You don't think so? I mean,
you
kind of incorporate everything.
Well, it's
going
to take time.
I don't know.
But a lease option, and Mr. Myers figured a payment in there. Mm-hmm. If we wanted to address these issues and get it up to our standards now.
This lease option would be, this is how schools can borrow money without going through the bond process. The bond process is expensive, with paying bond counsel and.
Who's this through then? Is this through a local bank?
Any financial institution, yeah.
Yeah,
And you figured those at 5%, which is probably pretty aggressive. It's lower than that for leases right now. That's one thing that's working.
When's it going to change?
Well, that's one thing that's working in our favor right now is interest rates are about as low as they can go.
Do we don't have to do any voting then with this?
No, no. As long as we keep that, we don't overextend ourselves in that capital outlay mill levy. You know, if we get too high there, we're going to be in trouble. Which is kind of why I put together the estimated budget there.
So what do you feel is the safest to tread waters in? So far as your budgeting and everything?
I wouldn't feel going more than $130,000 for a payment. And that's top end, I think, if we would do that. And, you know, that's $1 million at 10 years.
I would hope we would not need a 10 year.
No.
A 5 year would be.
Yeah, we probably ought to see what's going to cost.
Swing back over to your. You're saying 8 mills brings $336,000. So in your proposed budget, you're spending all that 8 mills, so your capital outlay isn't even growing.
Correct. Yeah. Now again, these other numbers, the 60, 45, 30, and 70, those are pretty flexible. You know, the technology is high. The vehicles won't always be that high. And the repairs and remodel, you know, some of that would be lower depending on what we take care of here too.
Well, I think we need to get our price on the library here and then see what the bathrooms are and how much we want to do. Go from there.
Well, if we're going to do that, I think we need to go through some sort of a.
Yeah, I think you have to hire a firm to tell us what it's going to cost.
And that.
Get some bids.
Energy.
He's not the architect.
So when we're talking restrooms, we're going to look at all of them and a recommendation from the firm on what they would propose we do to upgrade our restrooms. And then we can pick and choose from there. It may not be all of them. Right. We may not be able to afford that.
Right.
But we're talking about complete remodel.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm.
We're not talking about new toilets and stalls.
Right.
Okay.
Well, what's remodel mean?
It means in order to change what we have in there, you're going to have to tear the walls apart and redo the plumbing, redo the fixtures, and bring the stalls up to, and the dividers, bring them up to meeting our needs for this. Hot water. Faucets that are usable. Some of the faucets, you have to hold it on with one hand.
Yes.
So, I mean, how can the kid wash their hands? They can't even wash their hands with it.
That's just unacceptable.
Well, plus visitors use these restrooms too when they come for basketball.
Yeah, you might not have as many sick kids. You can get things upright.
You want your teachers working in a nice environment.
I think that's what we need to do.
Back on the 360 thing, I thought at the beginning of this that you had checked that their commission was not really any more than a standard commission on that. So if that was true, I don't really see why we need to find someone else to come in and look at it again, maybe if they were willing to do it, because it shouldn't be costing us any more.
Right.
Am I right or wrong?
Yes, you're correct.
Their low bid was around $250, if I remember right.
Right.
Well, and they were estimating. I honestly didn't think that they would be willing to work with us if we were just gonna do the library HVAC. I thought they would say, okay, find somebody to do that. I thought they would want a bigger project. When I talked to him the other day, he said, yes, we'd be willing to do that instead of the...
I'm good with them doing that, and then this other architect person going over to the other building and looking at the restrooms.
Okay, here's the other part of that. We're gonna have architects and engineers involved in the restrooms. And to me, it makes sense if we're gonna do that, just have the same firm dealing with this air conditioning.
Okay, well.
Then we all have one point of contact. We can...
Well, it might be good to compare.
Sure.
Right.
You know, see what they come up with. Because we have the 360 proposal. You know, he came and gave that to us, so we already know.
Yeah, and I wouldn't call those numbers firm at all. As far as what this is gonna cost.
But they looked at what needed to be done.
Yeah, yeah. And I feel very comfortable with his company. I do, I've checked on them enough to know. But if we're gonna have two different firms in here, that makes it more difficult to deal with. If we have one firm doing the architecture and the engineering, that makes sense to me.
So the question tonight, if we get this library HVAC looked at, and we look at the bathrooms, is this group comfortable with a lease if we need to?
It all depends on how much it's going to cost.
If we're going to do it, we're going to have to do a lease.
Right, so we need to
start with yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think
there's no
we
would
probably have to.
We
probably have to with these two to start with.
Yeah.
It just doesn't look like there's any way around.
No.
We don't have the cash, and we won't have the cash.
Would you throw in the track on that lease, or is that just kind of?
I think that can come later. That's my opinion.
I think you're right.
I think you got some more years out of that before it really has to be done.
I'd rather see the maintenance put in on the school. I mean, the projects on the school.
We can surely get by on that track by touching it up, and I want to
focus on the school. Touches everybody, staff right. And the students and everybody, where the track is.
It's way past due.
Mm-hmm. You're right, it is still way past due here.
And I agree with everything everybody just said there. The track, just so we're clear about the track situation, it's at 14 years on the surface. And those last 8 to 10 years is the expected life. And the worry is the surface underneath. If we're replacing $170,000 now, or we wait 5 years and the subsurface gets worse and we have to, we end up with a $300,000 repair. That's the danger. I'm not an expert on it.
The promises on the track from the last time didn't hold water anyway, so.
Or did.
Well, yeah, whichever way you want to look at it. Yeah, yeah. It was,
I'd rather do more for the population than the school.
Do you want to go on?
I do.
Now, let me switch gears on you.
Mm-hmm.
Earlier we were talking about the overall spendable cash. We needed to increase that.
Mm-hmm.
With all these numbers we just talked about, how is that going to get increased?
Doesn't change it. When I was looking at the, let me go back to it.
So it's not going to get increased then from 300. I'm talking about the 337,000. We need to have 620.
Yeah, this 377,000. I include capital outlay separate. That's money we can spend, but only on facilities. Okay. So I don't really even take that into account.
Okay. Okay.
That answer that question? Yeah, so even if we would start building that up to save for something else, I wouldn't consider that as increasing our cash balance. We can't pay teachers, we can't buy textbooks, we can't operate the school with that money. So that's why that's included separate.
Okay.
What would be our payment again on that $1 million?
Yeah, it's good.
Yeah, $130,000 for 10 years.
Well, the first step is to see where we're at.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
And then.
But our other option is bond.
If it gets, yes, yeah. If we're gonna get much more than this on that spreadsheet, it would need to be looking bond, because we wouldn't have the.
We need to be looking at that really hard. If those improvements are gonna cost us over $1 million, then we need to be looking at something different, because that ain't gonna work out. You can't spend $1 million in bathrooms.
No.
No.
I don't like anyone's advocating that. But something to say.
So our two priority projects, restrooms in the main building, all of them, at least as a starting point, HVAC over here. And what we're talking about here is really just getting this. We may have to add a boiler. We have one boiler. We need some redundancy there. That's going to be a recommendation, I know. And replace the chillers. That's really what we're talking about. Not upgrading the system. Really just kind of get back to what we've got and tie it into our control system. That's what we'd be looking at.
And it'd be a lot more higher efficiency.
Better be.
Okay, well, because you, you said get the same.
Right.
Anything else on capital planning?
Green deadline. It's getting confused between all your graphs.
Yeah.
Didn't know.
Air on the side is too much information.
Yeah. You put it.
So I guess what I'm asking for here is to approve the budget for this year. And again, this is more of a direction for me and the things that we talked about with the replacing the laptops, our fire alarm system. When the board approves this, then I know where I'm headed here with those things. And you know, we're talking about a $16,000 computer expenditure. This would be giving approval for those things within that budget. Of course, if we get above the $20,000, we need to bid it out and need to come for approval for that anyway. But the other part of the motion would be the vehicle replacement schedule. That's the 5-year replacement schedule. We've already discussed this year again. We would revisit this every year. This isn't binding the board to buy a bus in 5 years. So,
now going back to that. Sound system and the fire alarm system, are they intertwined? Is that what you said earlier?
No. The fire alarm system and the intercom system, they were kind of connected. That's partially why we need to.
So this would be taking it and separating it.
Yeah, and it's an old system. Fire code is, the fire marshal is going to require that we do that this year.
As far as the intercom system, do you use it? Or is that also the bell system and
it's
everything?
It's also the bells.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
And that's done and paid for out of last year's budget. It's not even part of this.
I don't know. Why would someone?
So that's what the recommended action sample motion is there for this year's budget and the vehicle replacement schedule.
Any other questions?
I have one more question. On the playground, does the PTO, I mean, I thought they were kind of doing a lot of that themselves. What are you intending on the playground?
There's what we've spent. We spent most of it between equipment and sprinkler. They didn't raise all the money for that.
Oh, okay.
They didn't have the capability of raising that kind of money. A lot of it was them recommending it and starting the project.
Mr. President, I move the board approve the capital outlay budget for 2013-14 and the vehicle replacement schedule.
Second motion.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the capital outlay budget for 2013-14 and the vehicle replacement schedule. Is there any discussion? All in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 7-0. Okay, disposal of excess property.
We talked about this with the vehicles. We talked about a lot of things since then. The number 21 is our handicap bus. It doesn't have much life left in it. It was going to take about $3,000 just to get it to pass inspection this year. So that's why we replaced that. We need to dispose of that. And bus number 22, we haven't used since I've been here, and it hadn't been driven at least 1 year before that. So it's time for that one to go. So that still leaves us with a spare on our route and of our activity buses, also that we can use in a bind if we need to. Those will go in Purple Wave auction site. That's pretty easy to deal with. I think that's our best bet to get the most money out of it.
Mr. President, I move the board approve the disposal of bus number 21 and bus number 22.
Second.
The move and second is to approve the disposal of bus 21 and 22 through Purple Wave. Is there any discussion?
One of them buses use a commercial on there.
Depending, 21, if the engine's good, it might bring $3,000. The other one, I don't know much about it. It hasn't been running. We haven't had it inspected, so it might bring $800 to $1,000.
Do they come out and look at it before they put it on there?
Yeah, they'll come out, and for government entities, they come out, take pictures of it, and get all the specs and everything, put it on their site, operate the auction, and the winning bidder pays them, and we actually give them the title when they come out. And then they'll transfer the money to us when they know the vehicle's changed hands. So.
1% today?
Nothing. For government entities, they don't charge anything.
Do we double check maintain like the antifreeze and kick the tires once in a while? I mean,
yeah, the bus drivers do.
Right, but I mean, these two have been kind of mothballed, so I.
Number 22 is not had maintenance.
Any further discussion? If not, all in favor, aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carried, 7-0. Junior high girls basketball, 6th grade.
We kind of anticipated this being a challenge this year. We want a full team to have full varsity and full junior varsity game. So Nick had requested that we look at this. We had 14 sign up, and that's kind of our goal, to make it work. There's some question about whether all of those girls would be a part of that. A little self-disclosure, my daughter's in 6th grade and she plays basketball. That doesn't affect my decision on this, but just to get that out in the open, just so everybody's clear on that. As Mr. Bergen, since we hit that number, Coach Garcia and Mr. Bergen needed to come up with a recommendation on that. So Mr. Bergen.
Yeah, I think with that, the number we were trying to get to 14, we had, and so Nick had girls sign up, and we're right on that number, and we wanted to kind of see if that gave us enough wiggle room to be able to have full B-team games, and so you could have kids play and develop just like what junior high school was. So we thought we'd do a sign-up sheet and see what we could come out of that. And like I say, we're right at 14. And we talked a little bit about the possibility if we wanted to have sixth graders come, talk to the sixth graders. That's, at best, we might get three, maybe four sixth graders. So, you know, we might have, then we might have 16 or 17 out. And you wouldn't have to worry about any numbers. It's hard to say because when kids sign up, that doesn't mean they're all gonna come out. You don't really know that till you start. And then when you start, after a few days, some last and some don't. So that's why when I talked to Nick, he kind of leaned toward he'd like to be able to have sixth graders. And then if it came to that, we wouldn't have to worry about numbers, but we would be within. If you get 11 or 12, it's kind of hard to play a B-team game. And you have, even though you got six quarters, you kind of have to watch and manipulate around how you get those in there. So. And really, I kind of, you know, when I talked to Nick, it was, you know, I'm okay if we have sixth graders play. It doesn't bother me. I mean, I'm not really that strong feeling one way or the other. Nick kind of thought it was okay to do that, so I was fine with allowing sixth graders to play because of the situation we might be in with numbers. Next year, it'll be even lower.
We will likely need to do this for a couple of years.
Yeah, for a couple of years.
Do we have to offer this to the boys as well then?
No.
We don't?
The boys should have 19 or 20.
And then my sixth grade parent for a boy, it might be.
Own parent, I have a boy, but it's not going to affect my decision. But I can see some people get upset.
So I'm asking.
They're all trying to pull one after the other.
Well, we've done it before.
We did it. Yeah, since I've been here, we've done it one other time.
Yeah,
since I've been here, we did it.
Caitlin was 7th or 8th grade or whatever.
Six, 7 years ago we did it or something like that. 7 years ago. 8 years ago.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Yeah.
But the only thing I don't like about it is if some of the 6th graders might take a starting position away from 7th or 8th graders.
That's their only chance they're ever going to start. Or
yeah, be. Could be. Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, I would say if we do let 6th graders, I think they ought to just play JV and not play on the varsity. I mean, so they can't. I mean, I don't know any of the girls personally, so I don't know what if there's some really good sixth graders or whatever, but I just think that 7th and 8th graders ought to be the ones playing varsity myself. Just that's the only time they ever get to start.
That sounds like a good compromise.
Because the reason we're pursuing it is so we can have a full junior varsity.
Well, I mean, that's why I see that. So, I mean, that's why I think that this is good.
Now, what you're asking for, would you see how many 7th and 8th graders go out before opening it up to 6th graders? Or would you just start out?
We want a decision. I think we just need a firm decision and move ahead and live with it.
I think you got your 14. Revisit this next year if you only got 11 or something. That's my opinion.
Well, I sure want to give the other kids that don't get to play varsity a chance to play JV, but, you know.
I don't know, with 6 quarters, I think they can make it work with what they've got.
We can with 14. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then they all go out and no one gets hurt.
You have a couple get hurt.
Sick.
You have one go out and sick, and you have a couple that aren't.
You play 3 quarters, one game, or whatever.
I mean,
they're going to play as much as they would if you had 17 or 18 out.
I don't think he would have come to us unless he was worried that he wouldn't be able to field a team. And it irritates me, you know, if we go somewhere and the kids only get to play half a game because the other school doesn't have enough kids.
Yeah.
So I think we should let them play. And just put the stipulation in that they will not sit on the varsity team bench.
All good points.
What about the boy issue?
Sorry.
It sounds like they got enough.
Yeah, I don't think you should do it if they haven't enough numbers with the boys.
It'd be easier if we had 17 girls or if we had 10 girls. It'd be easier to make a recommendation. It's right there on the borderline, so.
Yeah, I think you could easily, even though 14 signed up, I think you could easily end up with only 12. And then.
Or you could have 16.
You could. Or then two or three people are sick, or one person gets hurt, two people get hurt.
I know we've had high school, we didn't have a full two teams. Several times, volleyball and basketball.
They only had like seven or eight players.
Yeah, we went to state with eight.
For the sixth grade girls, we practice after school.
The State Department of Education actually outlines the rules for sixth graders in athletics. Activities Association doesn't even recognize that sixth graders participate. So sixth graders can't play football. They can only play one game a week, and they can only practice for an hour and a half a night. Kind of an interesting situation how that plays out. But, again, Mr. Bergen, if you had a recommendation here in this, what would your recommendation be?
Well, I would recommend that we have the option so that sixth graders could be out, just to make sure we have numbers. If I was definite and it was 100% sure that we had 14 kids going out, it might be a little different, but just based on what the people that are signed up, I just, but I mean, you know, that's just what I kind of think. But I mean, it comes right down to it. If we have 12, then we'll just make do with what we have. But it'd be nice not to have to worry about that.
So. Any other discussion before we put it to a vote? I'd entertain a motion if there is one.
I'll make a motion, let the sixth grade girls play, but not suit up for varsity.
I'll second that.
Moved and seconded to approve the sixth grader junior high girls to join the junior high basketball team for the 13-14 season with the stipulation that sixth graders do not suit up for varsity.
I also think that this needs to be understood, that this is not going to be every year. I know you guys said probably next year and maybe the year after that, but I don't think sixth grade girls ought to automatically think that they're going to start playing ball every year.
I agree.
There needs to be so we a have precedent. Games.
Yeah. You know, well, those sixth grade girls, would they still be able to play NAYB ball if they wanted to?
No. No, they're going to be on... Not during the season.
Not during the season.
They need to be on one team or the other.
Any further discussion?
All in favor, right hand. Opposed? Motion carried 6-1. Good discussion.
Moving on. Due process and collective bargaining.
This is an issue that came up last year in the legislative session. We discussed it maybe a little bit. Two separate issues here. One is a collective bargaining. This board negotiates with the Teachers Association. There are certain things that must be negotiated. If the teacher group wants to negotiate something, the board is required to negotiate that in good faith. It's been long-standing policy of the Kansas Association of School Boards and the members, which is you all, that the only things that boards should be required to negotiate are pretty much just pay and hours of work. On page 49, you have a list from KSB of just some things about negotiations. On the right side, there's a list of mandatory topics of bargaining. You can see a lot of things there. One example that a lot of people point to is wearing apparel. You know, if we want to have jeans on Friday, we need to talk about that and work that out. The longstanding policy, again, is using that example, boards should not have to negotiate that if they don't want to. And there's a lot of things there. I'm not going to go through all of those. And there's some other good information in there about negotiations, things you can negotiate, things you cannot. So outside of the mandatory list, there's things that you can negotiate, but maybe you don't have to. If they want to talk about it, you all don't have to talk about it. We just say, no, we're not going to do that. So a lot of information there. There's been a push from people in the legislature to get rid of collective bargaining. There's an attack on teachers' unions. A lot of it's political. Teachers' unions raise a lot of money for certain candidates. Those candidates' opponents won, and then they went after the teachers' union. The other issue is with due process, which is really tenure. When a tenured teacher is going to be non-renewed, there's a process to go through, documentation, and a hearing with the hearing officer, and that process is expensive. If this board and administration did everything right, there's a tenured teacher, everybody knows is not good, and there's a reason to get rid of that person, it's going to cost us $30,000 to get rid of that person. The system is broken. That should not be. If it costs too much money to get rid of a bad teacher, somebody that's not good for kids, that tells me the system's broken. Now, the problem is there's not a good solution. In my opinion, teachers need some protection. They need protection to make decisions about kids, about Tom's kid in their class, in the third grade classroom. Mrs. Dixon needs to be able to make tough decisions about that kid, even though it might upset people on this board. So there needs to be some level of protection. I don't know what that is, and there's been discussion about maybe multiple year contracts. Anyway, this is this item is on here for this board to direct me to let KSB know, is this a priority? Are either one of these issues a priority? They are not going to push it in the legislature if boards are not willing to stand up and say, fix it, change the system. My opinion, collective bargaining for us is not an issue. Since I've been here, what I've witnessed, it's not been a problem. Other districts, it is. Due process, again, I think the tenure laws need to change, but I don't know what the solution is until they come up with a good solution. That's not something I'm going to stand. I want to stand up and fight for personally as a superintendent. So, from the board, are these issues that you want to stand up and fight vocally?
If you don't know.
No, I don't know if you don't.
The collective bargaining, I don't see the benefit there. The tenure, you know, we all know that it needs to be to protect teachers so they can do their job, but sometimes it's abused. So that would be where to start. But as far as standing up and fighting, what do you mean?
If they bring these legislation forward in KSB, what happened last year is they stood up for what they thought the membership wanted was to change the tenure law and change collective bargaining, and superintendents and boards of education didn't back them up and call legislators and say, and tell teachers unions at home that these issues need to change, and this is our position, this is how we feel about it. And a lot of people think there's a lot more important battles, like funding, and issues with curriculum, and some people think we need to be united all together, teachers, school boards, administrators, and fight those issues first.
The funding is the big one, in my eyes, without that.
Yeah, but the tenure issue can overflow into your funding.
Yeah.
Or like you said, $30,000 to fight a problem.
And just do what the gentleman.
But.
We need funds to pay teachers, so we have good teachers.
I mean, I agree the teachers need some help, because sometimes they are standing alone in a lot of issues, even with just local school boards. Sometimes they feel like they're standing alone, but I don't think they should be protected forever, you know? When they're here, and I don't want to give a certain age or anything, but when they're here for a certain length of time, sometimes their energy has been exhausted, and you know what I mean? They just, we need somebody new and more energetic, bringing new ideas and stuff.
I don't think it has anything to do with your age. I think it has to do with good teachers and bad teachers.
Well, I'm just saying, I'm not saying an age. I'm just saying that there's, after you're here a certain length of time, it's kind of like doing same old all the time.
KASB isn't asking us to separate the two. They're asking if we want to do both, right?
No, you mean the collective bargaining or the team? No, it could be either or.
I thought it was something to do with a different eliminating the Board of State Board of Education. What was that other one that they were talking about?
What that is
and I thought, yeah, that's getting rid of your checks and balances.
They're not getting rid of the State Board of Education with their I'll have to look that up and send it to you. It's really about allowing the State Board of Education to act within the Constitution. And a lot of it has to do with the curriculum issue that's going on now. The legislators are trying to dictate what curriculum should be, and that's a constitutional obligation given to the State Board of Education.
Well, it seemed like they were talking about eliminating one, and I thought then you lose your checks and balances on both of them staying and going the same direction and stuff.
Yeah.
I can't remember what it was talking about.
Huh? Oh, I'm sorry, Mark.
No, that's fine. They were talking about that day. And
well,
you're just asking us to support changes in either one. Is that what you're asking
us to do? Yeah, and what KSB is going to do at the annual convention in December is the delegates from each school board is going to vote on that, whether it's going to be a priority or not. And they kind of want to hear from us informally as well, but formally at the convention and the delegate assembly. So
in the meantime, there will most likely be a lot of reading sent our way on these topics.
Mm-hmm. And, yeah.
And we can do our homework and make a decision then.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't think we have enough tonight.
No,
really.
So no. This is for information here.
Okay.
Yeah, not asking for a decision.
Okay. Any more on that?
Nope.
Okay. Move on to communications, board member activities, and reports. Start with Mr. Bear.
I attended the KASB new board member training back in September. And basically, the training focused on how to be an effective board member and an effective board. And set goals, have purpose, and take direction, and communicate. And Josh hung with me and helped me through it, and pretty informative, and that's all I have.
I just went through the afternoon session and just discussing a lot of political and different things that are going through and being talked about, like he was mentioning. So reviewing that, and I do agree that it's hard to stand up there by yourself and try to fight a battle and turn around and look and say, oh, nobody's following me. And that's basically what they were saying. They're trying to fight battles and people aren't following them. So they want to make sure everybody's getting on board now. Really appreciate that. So.
Myself, Josh and I attended the co-op meeting on 16th. The assistant director, Bud Moore, resigned. So that was basically dominated the meeting in a way. So
he got a different job, or he's just retired?
He retired. I should say that. He retired.
Okay.
So kind of talk like we've tried to go the year without an assistant director is kind of the feeling there. But so Andy, the director, he has some good leadership, I thought, and the gals that were down there. Bud did decide to retire midstream, so that's going to throw a little more work on the current staff. So keep you informed about developments there. Administrator reports. Mr. Allen?
Okay, I'll start. Start with Student of the Month. It's a new thing we started this year, just kind of a way of recognizing one boy and one girl each month. Chief Saylor found out about it, kind of talked to me, said that he'd kind of like to help with it. So he communicated with Poppy's Pizza and got like personal pan coupons or whatever to Poppy's Pizza. He came last Friday, presented our first Students of the Month. Our girl was Heidi Fisher, boy was Ian Engel. How it worked, each teacher nominated one boy, one girl, and then it was just a random drawing of each one. So we'll just kind of keep that process throughout the year, and he'll continue to come and present those. Barry Jones from Quivera did a crane presentation with our fourth graders. He came and talked about like the sandhill cranes and things about those. He's got a little contest going on with the kids where they predicted what date the crane is going to first appear on the refuge, and he's going to come back after that actually happens and present the winner with something. Our preschoolers, Kansas Parks and Wildlife, came, gave a little butterfly presentation to them, kind of talked about like monarch butterflies, had some butterflies in cases. That was interesting, some of the questions those preschoolers will ask, you know, about the butterflies. So that was kind of neat. Our fifth graders went to the Stafford County Conservation District Educational Field Day, spent the whole day out there learning about just different things. I think in the picture up there, it was I had a bunch of animal pelts and animal horns and things like that just to show the kids. So teachers reported that the kids were very well behaved that day. Kindergartners had Johnny Appleseed Day, I believe that was September 26th. They've kind of been doing apple units in their classes kind of for these first 7 or 8 weeks, and it kind of ended, I guess, with Johnny Appleseed Day, where they bobbed for apples that day, they had caramel apples, and kind of everything they did in class that day focused around the apples. So there's a couple pictures up there of the kids bobbing. And then last week, our first through fourth graders participated in the bike unit in their PE classes. Cindy Friesen really headed that up and talked to a lot of people within the community, got people organized to to help with their bike rodeo, and Thursday and Friday, the police officers and sheriffs took them kind of on a ride around town and followed them around. So it's kind of some different things that have been going on in the classroom. Administrative, I attended a student discipline workshop in Topeka at KASB, kind of focused on like due process, if you're going to do a short-term, long-term suspension, making sure that you follow proper procedure, how to discipline a student that has an IEP, just special things that need to be taken into consideration for that, a little bit about dress code, that type of thing. Next day, I went to a counting kids workshop in Hayes, which dealt with the state, or not in Hayes, in Hutch, which dealt with the state reporting, turning in numbers, which Mr. Myers showed you earlier, kind of where we sit in each grade. Our math curriculum development continues. Tomorrow and Wednesday, we have several teachers involved with that. They'll be working next door in the library here, just continuing to develop that math curriculum to be used in the future. On our in-service day, Joe Coles with Rachel's Challenge was here, talked about bullying behavior, things that you can be doing in your school, in your classroom, kind of to promote a more positive school environment, try to keep some of those bullying issues from happening. I think it was pretty active, and I think our teachers enjoyed that. And then Laura Davis gave me these September Life After School program numbers to report. Right now, we currently have 38 enrolled. During the month of September, they had 19 total days of programming, and students were served 388 times when you figure in kids that go different days. So on average, they're averaging about 20 per day with the Life After School program.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Berger? On enrollment, you see the enrollment is actually 7 through 12 are 159. On the, I think I mentioned this last month about the junior high band which performed the state fair. I think I did mention that. On September 19th, the FCCLA, they sponsored AT&T and some other groups are doing It Can Wait texting and driving. So the FCCLA kids organization, we had all the kids in the auditorium, went through, we had that, and the thing on the north side there on the window, you got that with a bunch of handprints. You see that? That's the kids signed the pledge about not texting and driving. So we had that on the 19th, had a video, and Trooper Shawboy was there, Adam was there. They talked to the kids a little bit about texting and driving. So, which obviously is important. So that went well, and that, we might do some more. They might do some more follow-up with that stuff as we go through the year. So, last week, Mrs. Hacker took some juniors. I think there's about 17 kids, some juniors, seniors that went to Barton Pratt for a career college planning activity just for the afternoon. As we get working with kids, more kids at each grade, preparing for a college and or a career, vocational something, after post-secondary. Administrative, we got school pictures. If you'd like to get your school picture on the 15th, you're welcome. Whip on over, get your mugshot taken, and come early well before school starts, when you look your best, and get it taken. As you all know, our classification, we are 2A. We are 9 through 12 as an enrollment of 107. It's information there, volleyball sub-state at Pratt, Skyline. We'll be playing tennis this weekend, this Friday at Cimarron. Our cross-country sub-state or regional is at Meade. On Wednesday, I'm going to Salina to schedule football for the next 2 years. That'd be a great time. That's another thing, if anybody would like to come along, help me, I can send you over by a table. So then if we have an open slot, I can wait, signal at you, and you can pick somebody up for me. You know, want to do that? Take your medication first before you go. There'll be about 900 people in there. And parent-teacher conferences are on the 28th. So, anyway, anybody have any questions?
When you schedule those football games, those will be 2A schools, or would it be just...
Eight-man.
Eight-man?
Yeah, they'll be, yeah.
So we'll still be eight-man, only will be... Yeah. 2A?
The 2A applies to all sports except football. Okay. In football, there's in football 11-man is two. There's two 1A schools together. I think there's 38 or 39 schools that are two 1A that play 11-man. And then if your enrollment, remember, if your enrollment 9, 10, 11 is above 100, you have to play 11 man. If your enrollment 9, 10, 11 is below 100, you have the option. You can play option, you can play 11 or 8. It, lacrosse's enrollment 9, 10, 11 is in the 70s, like 71, but they play 11 man. So most schools, if they're below 100, they play. Ellenwood's playing 8 man, their enrollment 9, 10, 11 is 97. And so they'll be playing 8 man. So the 2A and the 8 man, it's kind of confusing for football because really that classification lasts for 2 years for football and everything else just changes every year, or it could change every year. Yeah.
So is Ellenwood just 2A?
Ellenwood is 2A, yes. Mm-hmm. Their enrollment, I think 127, I think, is what their enrollment is, 9 through 12. Right. Yep. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
On websites, one of our professional development days, you know, with technology, it's one thing if it's easy to use, it's another thing if you have time to use it. So a few teachers came in, this is one thing they chose to do, they wanted to get their website updated. So on here, on elementary staff pages and junior senior high staff pages, this is the elementary ones. Barb mentioned, what about Mr. Olive? Mrs. Christie, kindergarten has her stuff on here, a little bio and then her schedule. And then she posts the kindergarten newsletters on there. That's kind of neat. And then some pictures.
I seen that on Facebook. Yeah. I was wondering why that went up there earlier.
We had the Monsanto grant presentation at a homecoming football game. We've got some of that stuff ordered and on the way here, $10,000, that's going to be for Mr. Delp's classroom, and the 20 iPads and then science equipment. They can plug the things into the iPad and collect data out of streams or soil samples and things like that, and compile the data. So that's a neat way to get that technology in front of the kids. I won't go over all these other things that have already been touched on, but our curriculum development, we're doing 2 days this week on that front. This is all related to the new standards with Kansas College and Career Readiness, which is really Common Core. There's been a lot of uproar about that, a lot of questions about that. I feel very confident with where we're headed with this. Our standards are not less. We're going to have the same standards as a lot of other states. That doesn't mean we've lowered our standards. Questions have been asked like, you know, it's not based on research or data, and it is. The National Council of Teachers of Mathematics, for instance, a lot of the standards are based on that. So if you have questions about things, I'd be glad to visit with you. I think a lot of the uproar is fear of losing control. We still decide our curriculum. We still say what is taught in the classrooms. We need standards from the state to tell us what do we need to achieve. We all need to be on the same page. If they just let school boards decide everything, we'd have 286 different curriculums. At some point, we need some level of continuity. A lot of the supporters of the Common Core are military families. Imagine moving every year of your school career in a different state, and you show up in third grade in one state, and you're covering the same thing you learned, half of the stuff you learned last year in second grade in another state, and then you're missing stuff. So it makes a lot of sense to do that. It's not the federal government telling us what to do. We still have that control. And a lot of what our curriculum is, development is understanding what it is and how to teach that. And it is going to be tougher. And I think our teachers are starting to realize that. Somebody, one of you, I don't remember who, asked me, what are the teachers thinking of that curriculum stuff? How's it going? Well, it's not very fun. It's hard work. And you know what the teachers want to be doing? They want to be in the classrooms with those kids. And that's the way I would want to be as a teacher also. But we also want their input on the curriculum. And it doesn't need to be a top-down dictate of this is what you should be teaching, and now go do it. We need some input from them on what we are actually teaching and learning what we should be teaching to fill in those gaps. So there's my, I guess, the short version of our curriculum. So it's going well. We're getting a lot of good out of it, I think, and at the end we will have our local curriculum for math, and then we'll do that again next year for reading. I'll just pass this around. This is the superintendent evaluation with the memo here. Take that, fill it out. I will email it to you as well. It's a lot easier if you could do that online. Save it and send it to Chad. If you can't do that, just fill it out by hand and then mail it to Chad. His address is on there. Email address is on there. It's okay if you just email it directly to him. If there are things that you don't feel comfortable just directly addressing with me, if there are things that you're frustrated with me in meetings or anything like that, feel free to write those down, and Chad can visit with those about me in private. I know sometimes it's awkward to have those interactions, but please be honest. So the goal would be to have that to Chad by the 18th?
Yes. If you would, please get it to me and get it compiled. And, we owe it to Josh to give him some good feedback, positive and things to work on. So.
And then he'd have time to meet with me before the next board meeting. We need to have it done officially by the next board meeting. This next year, we'll just have to do it one time a year. So 2 years we do it twice. Next year we'll just have to do it once from here on out.
So. It seems like we're always doing one.
Yeah.
Well, we have to twice a year.
Yeah. First 2 years of employment is twice a year.
I would write a question.
Sure. On that?
Click on that calendar up there. Whenever I click on the calendar, it just comes up with dates and nothing's ever. How come mine doesn't even do that?
I don't know. On your phone?
Yeah.
I don't know. Hit me up after the meeting, I'll show you. This calendar, if you use an online calendar, this is a Google calendar, you can download this onto your computer or your smartphone, or have somebody show you how to do it.
And you can do that.
And there may be something wrong. But.
And you can do that.
Uh-huh. Yep, you right on here, you can do that.
Yeah. No, you can.
Oh, I can shoot, yes, I can help you through it. Yeah. Probably, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. The regional meeting went very well. It's nice to for KSB that we hosted here. It's nice to have people here and show off our district. And Barb and Carl shared that information with you. The KSB convention is December 7th and 8th. If anybody would like to go to that, I can get you registered. It's in Wichita. It's 2 days. And we can assign a delegate if anybody wants to do that and go. We really need to have that delegate decided today so I can send this information to them. Is anybody interested in going and being the delegate? Or even if it's just one person and there may be, we could.
Kind of a slow time of year for you.
What's that?
When and where again?
It's in Wichita. It's at the Hyatt.
Aren't you the one getting the
December 7th and 8th.
Updates? Oh, who is? Is
that
you?
I am?
Yes.
Huh?
I have to bring my phone with me, and I have to look at my calendar.
Yeah. Policy updates. That means he should be our delegate, so he can vote.
Anybody on the board
can
do
it. You didn't know that was present.
Oh, and you said it was easy.
And we don't have to have a delegate. It's not necessary. You can go and not vote.
That doesn't look very good, though. I think Carl. Yeah.
You'll get more out of the session than you will out of voting anyway. It's my personal opinion.
Probably wine and onions.
I hear a train.
What do you need to know about?
I need to know tonight if somebody would be the delegate, and I can send that in. If we don't want to send a delegate, we don't have to do that.
I
Oh, look.
I think Chad wants to do it.
It's because Chad knows what they're going to do.
I've done it before. So someone else needs to experience it.
Steak and all sorts of stuff.
Okay.
Well.
See? Got some interest. You guys are missing out.
Is it the Hyatt?
By consensus, is everybody comfortable with Chad being the delegate?
He's getting the filet. You guys are.
Chance to get out of town.
Okay. Good enough. And if anybody, I'll send you the information about the conference. And if you want to go, I don't know what the deadline is. We have a few weeks to decide on that. Our financial software, we've updated our software. The conversion is pretty much all done with our budget stuff.
We are to a point to where we are up and running. Harris did a lot of the front end work. They loaded all of our vendors for us, loaded all of our staff, our salary schedule. I mean, there is still some cleanup work that I need to do because not everything, because of the timing issues, transferred perfectly, but that's part of it. It has some nice features. It's an entirely different setup, so Marla and I both are having to work through getting used to having to do things differently, but I think it's going to be way more effective in the long run. It has a lot better reporting capabilities than what our existing software did. The paycheck stubs are clearer for our employees, I believe. I don't think our certified staff has seen them yet, but I have had some feedback from a few teachers and they like it. Once we get the employee services portal up and online, pay stubs, if you're direct deposit, your pay stubs will all be available through a secure site that you set your username and password on. W-2 starting with 2013 and going forward will also be available on that secure website. It's just gonna make it nicer for the employees and a little more efficient for us once we get past the learning curve.
And this is all web-based, so backups and everything are not done here. So, God forbid we have a disaster, we don't lose all our financial information.
They also do all of the annual updates on federal income tax, state income tax, KPERS rates and changes. All of that stuff is done through them now as opposed to us having to be keeping up with it and be responsible for it and remembering to do it. So it makes it nice.
One more item, the school finance lawsuit, the oral arguments in the Supreme Court start tomorrow. It's kind of interesting to think about what might happen. There's going to be a showdown with legislators and the court, I believe. The legislature says the court can't tell us how we spend the money, and the court says it's the Constitution, and you're sworn to uphold the Constitution. So that will be interesting when that comes out. Our legislators that we send to Topeka, they put their hand on the Bible and swore to uphold the Constitution. And what higher authority with the state constitution is there than our state Supreme Court? I don't think they're going to throw them all in jail if they don't. I guess the lawsuit has to be decided first. So it'll be interesting to see how that all plays out. I'll try to keep you updated on that. But I don't see it changing life for us immediately. That's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Executive session personnel?
Yeah, I have just a few issues for personnel. Let's include Mr. Bergen. 10 minutes ought to do it.
Okay. Anyone else? Mr. Bergen?
Yeah, Travis, hang out for just a minute. Let me ask you to come in.
Okay.
right, entertain a motion.
Mr. President, I move the board goes into executive session for 10 minutes to discuss personal matters in order to protect privacy of non-elected personnel with Mr. Bergen and Mr. Olive to be included. And we return to the room in 10 minutes.
Okay.
I'll second that.
Move and seconded to go into executive session to discuss personnel items with Mr. Bergen and Mr. Olive attending for 10 minutes. All in favor, aye?
Aye.
Opposed, nay? Motion carried. We have a recommendation for an assistant high school basketball coach.
Yeah, Chad Freeze. If we get a motion to that effect.
I'll make a motion to hire Chad Freeze as an assistant high school basketball coach for the boys.
Second motion.
Move and second to hire Chad Freeze for assistant high school basketball boys coach. Is there any discussion? Not all in favor, aye?
Aye.
Opposed, nay? Motion carried 7-0. Also junior high in boys basketball.
Mike Bergen is the recommendation.
By default, 3 years in a row.
I'll make the motion that Mr. Bergen get to coach junior high boys basketball.
Get to?
Get to.
Yeah. Get to. There you go.
Move and seconded to hire Mr. Bergen to coach junior high and boys basketball. Is there any discussion? All in favor, aye?
Aye.
Opposed, nay? Motion carried. Motion for adjournment?
I move.
Second?
Second.
Move and second to adjourn, all in favor, aye?
Aye.
Meeting adjourned.